can really identify the particles and you can distinguish them. So this is applicable, for example, for a system of let's say a gas which is composed of several molecules. So the particles are distinguishable, and you can apply the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution or Maxwell-Boltzmann statistics in order to derive several properties associated with your collective particles or the system of particles. Okay, the other two were the other two were the first one was Fermi-Dirac statistics, and the next one was the Bose-Einstein statistics. So both of them, they are applicable for the quantum particles. They are basically non-distinguishable, and particularly the Fermi-Dirac statistics is applicable for fermions, and the Bose-Einstein statistics is applicable for bosons. Okay, so that was the story what we are discussing, and now today onwards we will continue to discuss the Maxwell-Boltzmann statistics, and we see that where the formula for the Maxwell-Boltzmann statistics will come from, and what we intend to discuss here. Okay, so in the last session, if you remember what I was trying to mention, that so let's say that we have a container, or let's say we have a system, and the system of particle or it's made of n number of particles, and let's assume that the total amount of energy of the system is E. Okay, so what may happen that this energy level of the system will be distributed, this entire energy E will be distributed. Can you see the cursor? Is it visible, the cursor? If I move the cursor,
Yes,
is it
sir.
possible
Yes,
for you
sir.
to follow?
Yes,
Yes,
sir.
sir.
Yes,
Yes,
sir.
sir.
Okay. Okay. So now what we are trying to do here, we'll try to derive the formula, which is for the identical and distinguishable particles, and we'll see that how this formula is applicable in order to derive the collective property of system of particles. Okay, so you see, total number of particle is n, and the total amount of energy of our system is E. Okay, and let's assume that this total amount of energy E is distributed in energy levels. So let's say that the total amount of energy distributed in energy levels are this E1, E2, E3, E4, and EZ. So it means this energy is distributed in these levels. And since we have n number of particles, so situation will be like that some of the particles they will be in energy level E1, and some of them, for example, N2 number of particles, they will be in energy level E2, or they will have energy level E2. And some of them, for example, N3 number of particles, they will belong to energy level E3, and so on. Okay, so in this situation, what I am trying to say here is that let's say that our energy of the system is distributed in energy levels, and these energy levels, for example, here total energy level is let's say E1, E2, E3, E4, and EZ. So EZ can be any number. So and in each energy levels, we have particular number of particles, and we are claiming that each energy levels, the particle is, for example, in E1 it is N1, for E2 it is N2, and for E3 it is N3, and so on. For EZ energy levels, we have NZ number of particles. Okay, now what we are interested in, we are interested in knowing the number of particles in each energy state. So, okay, so for example, or in each energy level, we would like to know what is the number of particles, means what is the value of N1, what is the value of N2, what is the value of N3, what is the value of N4, and so on. Okay, because these energy levels will be fixed, but the number of particles may change. Okay, because right now maybe at one particular time your system will have N1 number of particles in E1 states, or N2 number of particles in E2 states, but after some time it may change. Okay, but the energy level of your system will be the same, because we know, for example, in the quantum mechanics, as we know that the energy level of electrons are quantized. For example, you can take the similar analogy here, and we say the total number of energy or total energy levels available in the system is fixed. Okay, but the number of particles in each energy level, they may be different. Okay, so we'll do bit mathematics, so you have to bear with me for a while, but we'll see, ultimately you will appreciate that how we'll be able to derive the collective property of the matter at the end of the discussion when we'll derive the formula. Okay, so of course, if you have, let's say, z number of, for example, here if you have from 1 to z number of energy levels, and similarly, if you are trying to divide your total number of particles in this entire z levels, okay. So in this case, so number of ways of obtaining a particular microstate, we say it as, or we represent it in terms of omega or w, that can be given by factorial n divided by, means number of your total particles divided by number of your individual number of your particles in individual energy levels. Okay, so this is a typical way you try to find out that the possibility or number of ways obtaining a particular microstate. Okay, so what I mean when I say a particular microstate, so we are talking about, so for example, let's say at a particular time, if you have n1 number of particles in even energy level, n2 number of particle in e2 energy state, so this entire situation will tell you one particular microstate. Okay, so here what we are trying to write here, we are trying to write number of ways obtaining a particular microstate. Okay, and you see these e1, e2, e3, e4 and ez, they are not coming into the picture because these number are fixed. The only thing which is changing is the n1, n2, n3, n4 and nz, because the number of particles, they may change, they may change their energies. Okay, so you see, this is the way we will write a number of ways on obtaining a particular microstate. Okay, so generally this number is written as the omega or w. Okay, so this is basically omega or w. Okay, now you see what we can do here. So for example, if you want to find out the or let's say we want to simplify it, so what you can do it, or what you can write here, so you take the natural logarithmic of both the sides. So equation number one, for example, if you describe this as equation number one, and we take the natural log of both the sides, so you can simply apply the formula of logarithmic log, and you see that you can write this right hand side of equation number one in terms of log, and in bracket factorial n minus log in bracket factorial one factorial n1 multiplied by factorial n2 multiplied by factorial n3 and so on. Okay, and yeah, if you open it a bit more, so what you can write now, since this is multiplication inside, so if you take the log inside, so it will become basically log n1 factorial plus log n2 factorial plus log nz factorial. Okay, so because this is simply, if you have log m into n, so you simply write log m plus log n, nothing but simple simplification of your expression. Okay, so now if you remember, if you have n number of terms, or let's say z number of terms, and then you can write in terms of summation. So this is what it is done. So the quantity which is in the bracket, it is just written in a compact formula, and this is nothing but summation of I taking from 1 to z log n in bracket n I factorial. Okay, so if you because this is the symbol of summation, and summation means you are adding the quantities. So for example, if you will expand it, you will get this term. Okay, so this is the compact way of writing this entire bracket. Okay, otherwise we have to all the time we have to write this one. Okay, now there is a formula, and it's better to say it's an approximation. This approximation is known as Stirling approximation. Okay, and this is approximation which is used to determine the value of factorial, if you have a logarithmic of factorial n. Okay, so normally it is valid for a large number of n. So even even the n is comparatively small, you can also apply this formula. So for example, this approximation says that if you have logarithmic of factorial n, so you can write this in terms of n log n minus n. Okay, so this is a way to determine the value of log factorial n. Okay, so this is nothing but just writing this the value of your natural log of factorial n in terms of a Stirling approximation. Okay, so this is what is applied in the next term. Okay, so is it clear to all of you, or I'm doing I mean, this is just simple mathematics.
Sir, can you explain that part again?
In order Stirling of approximation.
Finding most, sir, in order of finding most probable microstate, value of ohm has to be maximum. So why it should
yes.
be maximum?
Yeah, so now what we are trying
yes,
to do here, you see, this value has to be maximum in order to understand, or in order to see that, for example, if you have a system and if you take a snapshot of the system, then the system should, in most probable case, it should represent the quantity, what a kind of, let's say, the information what you are retrieving. Okay, so this is what, if you are trying to maximize omega, then of course, only once you try to maximize the omega, that will give you the most probable state. Okay, so it means if you take a snapshot of the system, it will give it will represent that state. Okay, otherwise, what may happen that if it is not the most probable state, so what will happen that this state will not represent the entire system. Okay, so that's what it means. So we are considering the most probable state in order to get representative quality or representative property of your system. Okay, so that is why we are considering most probable state, and most probable state is I mean, in order to get the most probable state, we are trying to find out the maximum value of omega. Okay, and how will find the maximum value of omega, because you see in this expression, if you see this n1, n2, n3, n4, and so on, because the factorial n is fixed, because you know the number of particles is fixed. And the thing which may change is the individual or the number of particles in each energy levels. It might change, but the number of the entire particle is changed. So in order to find out the most probable state, what we are trying to do, we are trying to find out this maximum of our omega. And that maximum will depend upon the distribution of our particles in each energy levels. Okay, why we are doing that? We are trying to do it because we want to, if we, for example, we want to understand the property of our system at a particular time. So it's a kind, you know, we are trying to get a microstate which will represent the property of our system. Okay, so that's the most probable state we are trying to determine here. Okay, is that clear?
Yes,
does it make sense now?
Sir, one question.
Okay, so now, so that is the basic idea here. So you can also ask that why you are taking log here, for example. So of course, you know, if you see this omega and log omega, so if you're trying to maximize the value of omega, log omega will also follow that. So if you either you take, you're trying to maximize log omega or omega, that will basically the same thing, because if you take the maximum of omega or log maximum of omega, that will be basically give you the same stuff, actually same thing. Okay, so yeah, so this is what it is written here. So is that clear now?
Yes, sir.
So for example, if you
yes,
want to
yes,
understand
yes,
that how this Stirling approximation will come or is coming to play, so this is basically a way to get the approximate value of natural log of factorial n. Okay, so I would say this is a method to determine the value of any logarithmic factorial. Okay, so it is applicable to any large number of n. Okay, since we are dealing with large number of particles, particularly if you have a container or if you are dealing with a gas, you normally have large number of particles. So it means this Stirling approximation is valid in our case. Okay, so it is just a way to determine the value of factorial n. Okay, logarithmic of factorial n. Okay, is that clear?
Yes, sir.
So now you see what you do now. So if you have a paper and pen, I would appreciate if you can also do it. Okay, so here at if you're using the blackboard, then of course it would be really nice to do it in your copy as well, so you also follow that. So just take a paper and pen. So once you apply it, you'll also have the same feeling. So just apply this formula. Just apply this formula. This Stirling approximation in this expression where you have log of factorial n minus the sum of minus the summation I to 1 z log of n I factorial. Okay. Can you do it for me? Just do it. So just apply this Stirling approximation in this expression. This expression.
So this is natural log or log to the power base 10.
So this is natural log, not log 10. So I mentioned earlier this is natural log. Okay. So normally natural log you represent either log and then you have to prescribe the base or ln. So this is basically natural log. So base of this is basically the e. So yeah, so it's a natural log. Okay.
Sir, once again a quick question. What's that microstate means? E1 has n1 particles and e2 has n2 particles like that. Those are microstates.
Yeah. So microstate means what we are talking about here is that we have a system of particles. Let's say total number of particles is n. And the amount of energy in our system is E. And what we are saying that there are several particles. So total particle is, of course, N. So what will happen if there is energy level available in the system? So let's say that we have total EZ number of, or let's say we have Z number of energy level available in the system. So what will happen is these N number of particles will have, and some of them, they will have energy or they will be in energy level E1, and some of them they will have energy level corresponding to ET, some of E2, some of them they will have energy level corresponding to E3, and so on. Okay, so collectively in one situation, if you take a snapshot, so what it means that if you have energy level E1 and then the total number of particle or the number of particle which has that energy level or the total number of particle in that energy level is N1. So this entire situation will be one microstate. So where you have N1 number of particles for E1 levels and N2 number of particles in E2 levels and N3 number of particles is E3 levels. So what is fixed here? You see E1, E2, E3, E4 and EZ. So that this energy level of our system is fixed, but the number of particles in each energy level, they may change. Okay. So if the number of particles change, of course your microstate will also change. Okay. So the microstate means a snapshot of your system where a particular particle have a particular energy level, or the particular particles, they belongs to a particular energy level. Is that clear?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So just apply this formula and let's see what happens. Can you take a paper and pen and apply this formula? Okay. So you have to bear with me because you know sometimes if you have a mathematics, so it's not that complicated. It's very, very basic mathematics. But we'll see at the end, we'll get a formula, and in the later lectures, we'll see that how this formula is applicable to derive the properties of our the collective properties of our particles. Can you guys do it?
Sir, is it n into n minus 1 by 2 minus summation of I from 1 to n minus 1 I log I?
Okay, so it is done. So now it is here. So of course, the first term will become n log n. So again, I'm emphasizing these logs are natural logs. Okay, so this first term will become n log n. Okay, so as simple as it is written in the formula. And the second term, of course,
minus n.
And that would get cancelled by summation ni.
Sigma ni. Yes, sir.
Yeah, so n log see. Yeah. So here you see this. If you apply this formula here inside this summation, so you will see inside this summation I have used a bracket here. So let me now put it here. So can you see the screen? So now, so let me say, so the second term is this one, and which is what I written here in this bracket, okay? So this will become basically ni natural log ni minus ni, okay? So this is what it is, okay? And you have your summation. That summation is taking the I, value of I is going from 1 to z, okay? So you see here this n, there is a difference between n and ni in this term, okay? So n is basically this capital N is basically the total number of particle, and ni is basically representing the number of particle in a particular energy state, okay, or energy level, okay? So for example, if you vary I is equal to 1, because this the value of I is going from 1 to z, and z can be any number, okay? So it means sir, that there is a basic difference between basic difference
So there is a minus n missing, sir. Yes, sir. N log n minus n. Log n omega log is equal to n log n. First, sir. N log n minus n. Yes, sir.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, that's really nice way to point it out there. Here, that's good. Yeah, so here should be n log n minus n. So the term should come here, emerge is minus n, okay? So one mistake here in this equation, once you put the value of your log factorial n, so this will become n log n, and the another term that will come minus n has to be over here, okay? So it means there is a three term in this entire expression, one term is minus n, it has to be over here. So n log n minus n, and then minus, and then next this term, okay? So it should be clear to all of you.
Sir, sigma ni and minus n will be cancelled out.
So we'll see in the next, in the which you mean, which will cancel out?
Sigma ni and minus n.
So we'll do it. I mean, we'll do it in the next, in the next step, okay?
No,
so you see that, yeah, so this is the basic difference here between this the capital N and ni. So capital N is representing the total number of particle of our system, and ni is representing number of particle in a particular energy level, okay? So it should be clear to all of you. So for example, this I is taking the value from 1 to z, and z can be anything. Okay, so it means this n1, n2, n3, whatever the value will take, what this value will go, that will be the number of particle in a particular energy level. Okay, so now, of course, what will happen? So now all of you agree with this expression. So apart from minus n, the rest of the thing is okay, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So there is a minus n is missing here. So while you are doing your calculation here, put a minus n in this expression. Okay, because if you apply this Stirling approximation, you see minus term here over here. So minus n is over here. Okay. So this will become basically n log n minus n, and then minus this entire expression. Now, if you remember, so for example, if you want to find out a maximum of any function or any expression, what you do?
We differentiate it and put it equal to zero.
Exactly. So you differentiate it with respect to your variable, and then equate it to zero. So you will find the condition for occurring or for happening the maximum. Okay. So this is what we are also going to do in this expression. Okay. So what we are going to do here, in order to find out the maxima of our log omega, so what you do, you also simply differentiate it. So with respect to which we will differentiate it. So because here, most of thing, all of these quantities are fixed. This one is constant. So ni is basically the variable, because the number of particle in each energy level, it can vary. Okay. So what we are doing here, we are simply differentiating this entire expression, and we will put it equal to zero, and we'll see what we get. Okay. So you see, this is del log omega is equal to what will happen to this expression? N log n minus n. What will happen to
zero.
That?
That's a constant.
Why it is zero?
Constant.
Because of n, because of capital N is constant, because number of particle is constant. We are not allowing the particle to go outside of our system, or we are not allowing particles to come inside our system. So basically your number of particle is fixed, That is why the moment you differentiate this term, n log n minus n, that will become 0. Okay. Now we'll differentiate inside here in this bracket. You will see this is composed of two variables, or let's say two terms. So the first one is ni and second one is log ni. So how we'll do it? So if you have two function, you want to differentiate it, then what you have to simply do, you have to just apply the formula of yes, exactly, the chain rule, or you simply. So first here in this expression, what I have done here, first I differentiated ni, and then then log ni is already there, plus, and then you leave the first term and differentiate the second term. So this ni is here. Now the moment you differentiate log ni, you will get 1 over ni, and then del of ni. Okay. And then the last expression is minus ni. So if you differentiate it, so that this is written in terms of minus del ni. Okay. So now this is what it is done. So we have, in order to find out the maximum value of our maxima of our log omega, so we have just differentiated this expression, and now we are going to put it equal to 0. So you see here, there is a way, there is a possibility to simplify this expression, because you know here, if you can follow the cursor, this ni and ni will cancel each other. Okay. So what you will left with, you will left with plus del ni, and then here it is minus del ni. So basically what will happen in it, first these ni and ni will cancel each other, and then next term you will see you will have plus del ni minus del ni. This term will cancel each other, and you will only left with the first term, which is given in this bracket. Okay, this is what it is written here. Okay, the first term, you see, we started from here, the first two terms became 0, and then you see in this term, the last two terms become they canceled each other, and we are left with only one term, which is this one. Okay, so this is what it is written here. Now del log omega is equal to summation I is going from 1 to z, and in bracket it is del ni log ni. Okay, and now of course we are trying to maximize the value of log omega, so simply it is written is equal to 0. Okay, now so this is what is the constraint we are working with apart from this. So the constraint is that the number of particle is constant, so it means doesn't matter. So if you are integrating, for example, if you are integrating, if you are adding the total number of particles. So for example, you see here. So we have total number of particle is n. So what will happen if you add n1 plus n2 plus n3 plus n4 and nz? So what will be the value of this? If you add n1 to nz, what will be the value?
N,
exactly. So if you write down in terms of summation, so for example, I is going from 1 to z ni, so it means that is equal to n. Okay, so this is what it is written here. So now you see, if you write summation I is going from 1 to z ni, forget about del for a moment. So if you write the number of your particles in terms of this summation, so just forget a moment this del. So this will become basically I is going from 1 to z, ni is equal to n. Now if you differentiate it, of course, because the number of particle is constant, it will become 0. So this is what the equation number 3 is. Okay. So we are saying that since number of particle is constant, so it means if you differentiate it, you will get 0. Okay. And we'll apply the same thing with the total energy. So for example, the total energy of our particle is also constant. So now you see how you will get the total number of total energy of our system. So what we say, we have energy level EI, we have NI number of particles in the energy state EI. So if you simply multiply these two quantity and you integrate it from I is equal to 1 to Z, you will get your entire energy. Okay, is that clear to all of you? So let me go back and explain it in the beginning here. So for example, you have since this is the entire energy, okay, of your we are saying the total amount of energy of our system is E, and you have in each energy levels, if you have n1 number of particles, for example, in case of E1 energy level, you have n1 number of particles, you have in E2 energy level, you have n2 number of particles. So for example, if you want to write out the total amount of energy in your system, so what you have to see, how many particles they have energy E1, so it will become basically n1 multiplied by E1, how many particles they have energy level in E2, so basically E2 multiplied by N2, okay. So in order to find out the entire energy of your system, so what you have to do, you have to multiply by the each energy level and the number of particles available in that energy level, okay. So this is how you will get the entire energy. So it means E1 N1 plus E2 N2 plus E3 N3 plus E4 N4 plus and so on plus EZ NZ is equal to E. That's how you will get the total amount of your energy in the system, okay. This is what it is written in a compact notation form, okay. So if you expand it from for example here, if you expand it, so from E is equal to 1 to Z, so the first term will become E1 N1 and the second term will come plus E2 N2 plus third term will become E3 N3, okay. So you have to add it up to EZ because the Z number of energy level you have in your system, okay. So that will basically give you the total amount of energy in your system. Is that clear to all of you how we are getting this expression?
Yes sir, yes sir,
yes sir, yes sir,
yes, sir.
Right. हम क्या कर रहे हैं, जितने भी आपके एक इंडिविजुअल एनर्जी लेवल में जितने भी पार्टिकल्स हैं उनको मल्टीप्लाई कर रहे हैं एनर्जी से, एंड वी आर गेटिंग द एंटायर एनर्जी, ओके. सो एज सिंपल एज दैट. नाउ इफ यू डिफरेंशिएट फॉर एग्जांपल हियर, सो यू विल सी इफ यू डिफरेंशिएट दिस टर्म, सो व्हाट वी विल गेट, सो यू विल सी हियर, ऑफ कोर्स ei इज कांस्टेंट बिकॉज यू नो द एनर्जी लेवल इन अ सिस्टम इज फिक्स्ड, दिस एनर्जी लेवल्स आर नॉट चेंजिंग. The quantity which is changing is the number of individual particles or number of particles in each energy level, right? So it means in this expression, if you see in this expression, EI is basically is fixed, it is not changing. The quantity which is changing is NI, okay. So if you differentiate it, for example here you see, so the differentiate it means this term will the EI, you can take it out, or you, of course it has to be inside the summation, but the differentiation will not be applicable to EI. You can treat it as a constant. So del NI is equal to zero because you know the total energy of your system is constant or fixed. So it means if you differentiate it, you will get this term. This is equal to zero. Okay. So now what we are trying to find out, so we are trying to find out the maximum of our del log omega having two constraints. The first constraint is that the total number of particles is constant, and the second constraint is that the total or the entire energy of the system is constant, or total energy of the system is constant, okay. So this is the two constraint we are using in order to find out the maxima of our log omega, okay. So you see in your previous studies, probably you have dealt with those cases where you have to find out the maxima, and you simply take the you differentiate it and put it equal to zero, and then you will try to get out the maximum. Now here we are in a situation where we have to find out the maxima of our quantity having two constraints, okay. So the constraint one is number of particles, that is fixed. Constraint two is the number of total amount of energy, that is also fixed, okay. So yeah, so what we are trying to maximize a function with two constraints. So the method we are going to determine, or method we are going to use, is so called Lagrange method of undetermined multipliers, okay. So there is a way to determine, there are different ways to determine the maxima of a function there are certain conditions are given, okay. So one way to do it is called as the Lagrange method of undetermined multiplier. So we are going to use that method in order to find out the maxima of our function, okay. So it is one of the method to find out maxima of a function if you have certain constraint, okay. So what we'll do, or what is the method, I will just briefly describe here. So for example, we have this equation number 3 and equation number 4, and we have our equation number 2 here. So in the equation number 2, we have our function or we have our quantity, to whom or the quantity for which we want to find out the maxima, and the conditions are given in equation number 3 and equation number 4. Okay. So what is done in this method is that we take this equation number 3 and 4 and we multiply by two constant or two values, this alpha and beta, and then we equate to 0. Okay, so for example, in equation number 3 and equation number 4, so in equation number 3, what we'll do, we will multiply by alpha, and equation number 4, we multiply by beta, and then we'll add these equation number 2, 3 and 4, and we put it equal to 0. This is what it is done in this expression over here. Okay, so we'll see. It is written in a compact form. The thing which has been done is that in equation number 3, we have multiplied by alpha, and equation number 4, we have multiplied by beta, and these three equations, equation number 2, 3 and 4, they have written in the compact form here. So you see three terms are there, 1, 2 and 3, they have been added and kept it equal to 0. This is what it is done. And if you do it, and since you see this del ni will be common, so let me go back. So this del ni is also present here. Del ni is also present in equation number 3. Del ni is also present in equation number 2. So what we can do, we can simply take it out, means just take it outside the bracket, and we keep rest of the item inside the bracket, and we simply add this equation and put equal to 0. This is what it is done. So you can also do it, just take your paper and pen and you will do it by yourself, and you will see that how this term is coming. Okay, so this basically, this term is the equation number 2, and this is basically this term alpha, because you know in this equation number 3 we only have this summation of I is equal to 1 to z, del n I is equal to 0. Okay, so if you multiply by alpha, so and you take this del n I common, of course you will only be left with alpha. And similarly, if you see the equation number 4, you have this ER multiplied by del ni. So of course, if you take del ni outside, you will only left with beta multiplied by EI, because we are multiplying by beta. And let's put it equals to 0. Okay. You see here, now since this total number of particles, so here you see the number of particles ni, or the change in the number of particles, is not equal to 0. Of course, you will have number of particles, and number of particles will be changing from one microstate to the other microstate. So of course this cannot be 0. Okay, so this quantity cannot be 0. It means this quantity which is inside the bracket, that has to be 0. Okay, because this is not 0, this is a non-zero quantity, and then the quantity which is left, that has to be equal to 0. Okay, and this is what it is written here, that log of ni plus alpha plus beta ei is equal to 0. And if you take the rest of the quantity apart from log ni, the other side, so it will become minus alpha minus beta ei. Okay, and of course if you want to get rid of log from the left hand side, so what will happen, ni is equal to e to the power minus alpha minus beta ei, and now you can simply take it ni, and you can write it in terms of ni is equal to 1 divided by e to the power alpha plus beta ei. Okay, so this is just simple mathematics. Whether you guys manage to follow it or it is complicated, I hope it is not that complicated.
Yes, sir.
Right, so just I will briefly put it here. So you see, we have to, once we do the mathematics and we will find a function, and that function will tell us about the properties of the material or properties of a collective amount of particles. We will appreciate that. So for a while you have to deal with the mathematics, but ultimately once we have the entire expression, you will appreciate it. Okay, so we have done nothing, we have simply taken some of these this simple basic fundamental mathematics in order to get the value of ni. So now you see in this expression what we have ni and is equal to 1 divided by e to the power alpha plus beta ei. Forget about alpha and beta for a while. So you see right hand side what we have and left hand side what we have. Left hand side we have ni. What is ni? What we started with. Ni is representing the number of particles in ei energy level. Okay, that's what it means. So if you put I is equal to 1, so it will correspond to n1 corresponding to energy level e1. So ni is representing the number of particles in ei energy level. Is that clear to all of you?
Yes, sir.
Right hand side, what it is, right hand side, if you see ei is basically ei is telling you the energy level of your energy level of the particle. So ei is basically corresponding to the ei energy level having ni particle. So basically what this relation is giving, this is basically we are getting or we are trying to, or there is an expression here which is correlating the total number of particle or the number of particles in ei energy state. Okay, so that was the intention. What we wanted to find out, we wanted to find out the number of particle in a particular energy state. Here you see this number of particle in a particular energy state. Okay, so that is the expression we'll deal with the next class. Okay, so we'll continue from here onwards and we'll see. Right now the takeaway message is we have an expression ni is equal to 1 divided by e to the power alpha plus beta ei. So this ni is telling us about the number of particles in ei energy level. So this is the expression what we have. Okay, so we started with the intention to determine the number of particles in a particular energy level, and we have expression or at least a function which is representing the same or which is giving giving a hint or giving the, that number. Okay, is that clear to all of you,
sir?
Yeah.
Sir, is it the ni and ei both are inversely proportional to each other? Sir, by the expression, I can say that if suppose in n1 and n2 state, if n2 is more than n1, then ei, then e1 is greater than e2. We can say, can we say that?
Or no, EI since is, right now here. Yeah, so right now we are here, we are trying to determine the number of particles in a particular energy level. Okay, here we are not correlating. Yes, here we are not trying to correlate what will be the for example, the if you have n1 number of particles in one energy state and e2 number of particle in another energy state. So of course, you know, the total amount of energy in a particular energy state will also depend upon how many number of particles you have there. Okay, and of course this, for example, if you have this e1 e2 e3 and so on, so if the amount of energy is increasing, let's say in e1 energy level or e2 energy level or e3 energy level, if the amount of energy is increasing and your amount of particle or number of particle is decreasing or increasing, so it that will decide whether a particular energy state will have or how it means it will be what will be the contribution of a particular energy level in the entire energy system. Okay, so right now we are only trying to determine the number of particles in a particular energy level. That's the intention. Is that clear?
Okay sir, clear.
Okay, so we started with the intention that we want to find out that what will be that. So let me go to the first part and then we end our discussion here. So yes, so here what we said we have a total n number of particles and the entire energy of our system is E, and then we said the system has Z energy levels. And these Z energy levels are represented by E1, E2, E3, E4, and EZ. Okay. Now we said each energy level have a particular or have a certain number of particles. Okay. So we said that E1 energy level has N1 number of particles, or in other way around, N1 particles are in E1 energy levels, N2 particles are in E2 energy levels, N3 particles are in E3 energy levels, and so on. Okay. Since we know this E1 E1, E2, H, they are fixed, they are not going to change. The thing which is changing is the number of particles in each energy levels. Okay. So the intention was to derive a relation or to derive a formula where or to determine the number of particles in each energy levels. And that's what we did. Okay. So we derived a formula where we get total number of particles in a particular energy level. Okay. Is that clear to all of you?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, that's good. So that's what the intention for today. So tomorrow we'll see, we'll take this formula which we have derived and we'll try to correlate the collective property of collective properties of a system of particles. Okay. Okay, so let's meet tomorrow at 8 o'clock, right?
Thank you, sir.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
So I'm just going to share this. Thank you. Yes, this. Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Point. Yes. Okay, guys. So let's meet tomorrow, and then we continue our discussion. Okay. So I will just share these three notes, so you will have, so that you can follow the discussion point of discussion. Okay. If you have any question, you can also post in the MS team, or you can also send a message to me. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay then. Yeah.
Sir.
Then till tomorrow. Yeah. Any question? Anything? Anybody want to ask?
Sir, वहाँ पर आप differential try किए थे वो maximize करने के लिए most probable state में वो differential क्यों किए थे sir?
What we wanted to see, we wanted to find out, इसलिए हम उसको differentiate किए थे क्योंकि हमको most probable state चाहिए थी, ठीक है? Most probable state के लिए आपकी जो value है omega की, you wanted to get a maximum value of your omega, ठीक है? So that it will represent collectively your system, okay? That is the main motivation in order to do this differentiation. वही main idea था उसको differentiate करने, क्योंकि आपकी जो omega की value है, you want a higher value of omega, ठीक है?
सर वो किसके respective में आप differentiate किए उसको?
उसको ni के respective में differentiate किए, क्योंकि आप देखेंगे ni ही एक quantity है जो variable है उस system में, बाकी rest of the quantity is same. Apart from ni, there is no other variable. Okay.
तो delta क्या है?
Del is a way to write the differentiation in a short form, or I would say just write down the form of way to write down that you have differentiated quantity. Okay.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Anyone else?
Yes.
Okay. Then if not, then let's meet tomorrow, and then we continue our discussion. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Meanwhile, if you have any question or if you have any doubt, so you can also post in the MS team, or you can also send a message to me in the MS team. That is fine.
Okay.
Okay. Just one more stuff. Just wanted to say that don't afraid of mathematics. So maybe in order to derive certain quantities or derive a formula, we have to deal with a certain amount of mathematics, but that mathematics is just a fundamental mathematics. You will be easy to just follow it. So the thing what you need a paper and pen to follow it. So if you do it by yourself, it would be really nice. You will understand each and every expression, that where it is coming, what kind of approximation we are using, and why this term is emerging. ठीक है? तो आप खुद से करेंगे तो थोड़ा सा आपको अच्छे से होगा, आइडिया लगेगा उसमें. Okay. So let's meet tomorrow.